Penguin Random House Audio presents The One Inside by Sam Shepard. Read for you by Bill Pullman, with a foreword written and read by Patti Smith.
Why does no one take you aside and tell you what is coming? David Foster Wallace.
Foreword. There were four horses grazing beyond the fence, black butterflies alighting on the fallen pears. You could already feel the approach of autumn, a golden Kentucky afternoon. Sam was looking out the window. I was at the table, reading his manuscript. Glancing up at him, it occurred to me that everything I ever knew of Sam, and he of me, was still inside us. I thought of a photograph of the two of us in New York City, walking past an automat on 23rd Street some 40 years ago. It was shot from behind, but it was us without question, about to embark on separate paths that would surely cross again. The manuscript before me is a dark compass. All points proceed from its magnetic north, the interior landscape of the narrator. Unable to tear myself away, I read straight through the afternoon, navigating a mosaic of echoing conversations, altered perspectives, lucid memory, and hallucinatory impressions. The narrator awakes in the midst of a rude metamorphosis. Coordinates are shuffled, but the hand is familiar. He's been an actor for most of his adult life, enabling a kind of travel that requires no passport, just a truck, script, and his dogs on the scent of nostalgia. The smells of donuts, steam, waffles, and coffee spilled out across the busted-up yard and into the vast dark desert. Speechless men hauled huge, heavy boxes on iron wheels across the gravel. Now and then, one of the forms would emit a nod or a groan, but the world remained enigmatic, shrouded, and unspeakable. He has dreams of his father, the tiny man, who is not so tiny. He describes the minutiae of these recurring dreams with haunting hilarity, reminiscent of Japanese manga comics. He attempts to run, separate himself from his father and all his indiscretions, but is condemned to repeat them. Time frames. The faces of women meld into one another. His father's young lover, Felicity, and her mouthy mother in a pink coat. The two young, ambitious, and elusive blackmail girl. His wife of 30 years driving away. They come and go and return again. After a while, you get to know them. Their images intricately fabricated through fast-moving prose, liberal smatterings of poetry, monologue and dialogue, the visceral language of flickering home movies. He loves his wife, but they just can't get along. He's beguiled by the blackmail girl who is something of himself, testing and weighing reactions. Circling back in time, he collides with his younger self, naively entwined with his father's Felicity, a tragic character pulled like taffy, vacillating between innocence and desire. Her mouth opened and I saw tiny animals escaping, tiny animals trapped inside her all this time. They flew out as though something might catch them and drag them back into imprisonment. I could feel them land on my face and crawl through my hair, searching for a hiding place. Each time she screamed, the animals flew out in small clouds like tiny gnats, little dragons, flying fish, headless horses. Throughout life, he is captivated, confused, and amused by women, drawn toward them yet compelled to skip out. But in the end, it's not so much about the women as the shifting core of the narrator. We travel the coils of his prismatic mind, his weary heart, not through confession, but a potent honesty, a fascination for not caring. The truth is that he may be changing, yet he remains unchanged, the running boy, the empowered adolescent, the seething man whose muscles betray him. He's a loner who doesn't want to be alone, grappling with the incubus, a rippling of nocturnal waters, the nausea of unending nights. There are troubling moments of prescience as he intuits future fragmentation, stoically kicking his way through the shards. He's just going to keep on living till he dies. Whether he paints himself in a good or bad light is not the point. The point is to lay stuff out, smooth the curling edges. I set down the manuscript. It's him, sort of him, not him at all. It's an entity trying to break out, make sense of things. A tapeworm slithering from the stomach, through the open mouth, down the bedsheets, straight into the bleak infinite. You are now traveling. Your future is frozen. Rapidly, you are jettisoned from the blank unknown to the bright, clear world. I notice the light has changed, a burnished twilight that quickly ushers us into the night. I get up to examine an image that Sam had tacked, slightly askew, in a niche above the kitchen sink, a madman woman shaman with a boombox. Where was that taken? Somewhere in the Sonora Desert. Is it real? Maybe, he says, but who knows what is real anyway? Reality is overrated. What remains are the words scrawled upon an unwinding panorama, vestiges of dusty stills peeled from memory, a threnody of gone voices drifting across the American plain. The one inside is a coalescing atlas, marked by the boot heels of one who instinctively tramps, with open eyes, the stretches of its unearthly roads.
The one inside. They've murdered something far off, fighting over it. Yes. Screaming. Doing their mad cackle as they tear into its softness. He's awake. 5:05 a.m. Pitch black. Distant coyotes. Must have been. He's awake in any case. Staring at rafters, adjusting to place. Awake even after a full Xanax, in anticipation of small demons, horses with human heads. All small, as though life-size were too big to fathom. His dogs are on the muscle, howling from the kitchen in feral imitation. Vicious cold again. Blue snow biting at the windowsills, glowing on what's left of the full moon. He throws the blankets back with a bullfighter's flourish and swings both bony knees out into the raw air. He comes almost immediately to a straight back sitting position, both hands flat on his thighs. He tries to take in the ever-changing landscape of his body. Where he resides? Which part? He peers down at his very thick blue thermal hiking socks, pilfered from some movie set. Piece of some costume, some character, long forgotten. They've come and gone, these characters, like brief, violent love affairs, trailers, honey wagons, morning burritos, craft service tents, phony limousines, hot towels, 4 a.m. calls. 40-some years of it. Too big. Hard to believe. Too vast. How did I get in here? His aluminum trailer rocks and sways in the howling Chinooks. His young face staring back at him through a cheap 4x4 mirror surrounded by bare light bulbs. Outside, they're shooting film of grasshoppers falling in great swirling cones from the belly of a rented helicopter. They actually are. In the background, winter wheat, as big round as your thumb, blows in rolling waves. Now, perched on the very edge of his firm mattress, staring down at his thick blue socks, white puffs of breath vaporizing in the morning dark. He knows it's all come true. He just sits like that for a while, straight-backed. A great blue heron waiting for a frog to rise. The house doesn't creak. It's made of concrete. Outside, the aspens moan. He doesn't feel the cold now. It crosses his mind that it's been over 2 years since the very sudden breakup with his last wife, a woman he'd been with for almost 30 years. Crosses his mind. Pictures. The source? Am I whining now? He asks himself in the voice of a small boy. A boy he remembers, but not him. Not this one, now, quaking in blue thermal socks. 6 a.m. Wind just now quit after furious blowing out of the south for 3 days straight. Air still and much warmer. House even feels hot. Thought, today I'm exactly 1 year older than my father was when he died. Weird thought, as though it were some kind of achievement rather than raw chance, rather than happenstance. Pull off black silk long handles. Female. Electric blue crackles of static. I see sparks shooting from my chest. Electricity is in me. Take the many pills prescribed by acupuncturist. Line them all up. Colors, shapes, sizes. Don't even know what they're for. Just do what you're told. Somebody must know something. Do what you're told. First light cracks through the pinions. Dogs dead asleep on the kitchen floor, splayed out like they were caught suspended in a gallop. Make coffee in old stained pot. Dump yesterday's grounds. Mice rustling in heat vents, searching for warmth. Thinking about Nabokov's answer to why he writes, aesthetic bliss. That's all. Aesthetic bliss. Yes. Whatever that means. Tiny man. Early morning. They deliver my father's corpse in the trunk of a 49 Mercury coupe, dew still heavy on the taillights. His body is wrapped up tight in see-through plastic, head to toe. Flesh-colored rubber bands bind it at the neck, waist, and ankles, mummy style. He's become very small in the course of things, maybe 8 inches tall. In fact, I'm holding him now in the palm of my hand. I ask them for permission to unwrap his tiny head, just to make sure he's truly dead. They allow me to do this. They all stand aside, hands clasped behind their tailored backs, heads bowed in a kind of ashamed mourning, but not something you would question them on. It's smart to keep on their good side. Besides, they seem quite polite and stoic now. The mercury idles with a deep, penetrating rumble I can feel through the soles of both shoes. I remove the rubber bands carefully and uncover his face, peeling the saran wrap away from his nose very slowly. It makes a sticky sound like linoleum coming free from its glue. His mouth opens involuntarily. Some delayed response to the nervous system, no doubt, but I take it as a last gasp. I put my thumb inside and feel his rough gums. Little ripples where his teeth used to be. He had no teeth in life either, the life I remember him in. I rewrapped his head in plastic sheathing, replaced the rubber bands, and hand him back over, thanking them all with a slight nod, trying to stay in keeping with the solemnity of things. They take him carefully from me and place him back in the dark trunk with the other miniatures. There are shrunken women wedged on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.